So therefore, as my cylinder moves to full extension, did I turn that back on for you?
No, it's okay. It's on now.
Oh, okay. Well, you haven't missed very much yet.
Oh, okay. It's almost lunch, by the way.
Yeah. So
it's lunch.
Yeah, I'll just leave it alone because I don't know if you're turning it on or off. So.
Okay.
So my flow is coming through here. My cylinder extends. At the end of my extension stroke, pressure begins to build. It builds down in through here. It's going to build over here into this chamber. That is what's going to happen. This unit will now open, and it will dump at 1,000 PSI. So I can do a certain amount of work with that particular setup. Now, when we look at this valve, I've got a little squiggly line here, and I've got a little squiggly line over here. Those are springs. So when I deactivate this solenoid so I don't bring any more electricity into it, what is this spring going to do?
It closes the center again.
Sure. It's going to take this unit here, and it's now going to push it back over here. I'm now in my neutral condition. So therefore, this is going to stay open and dump the tank. If I look at it this way, that I activate this side of my directional control valve, then this flow path comes in. And you can see my crossover. My oil comes from my pump, in through my crossover, up through here, and it now brings the rod back, right? The oil on this side is going to cross over this way, and it now returns the tank. So when you look at that particular directional control valve, that is what's causing the movement up there within my cylinder. Are you guys with me on that?
Oh yeah.
So I want you guys just to think about that, you know, for the next maybe day or so until I get into hydraulics. Because this, if you guys can have a pretty good understanding of this, then it makes the pump section in chapter 14 much easier. It's going to make chapter 16 in hydraulics much easier, and it's also going to be chapter 17 for your pneumatics much easier. So this is basically my setup. This is what I'm doing. Okay? Let's go for lunch. Let's take half an hour. I'm going to need a half hour break to get my brain settled back down here. So you men going to break for lunch? Okay. What can I do to improve things here? Are you guys okay with what's going on?
One thing is if next time you do a drawing, you do bigger, you get a small screen, you can't even see what's happening.
Okay. Okay, I'll do that.
Big thing. That's good.
Okay. So you're right, okay.
Yeah, so right downtown, well, just off Jasper, 113, so. And then Uber was like a $10 cab ride here.
That's not bad.
Yeah.
Is your company helping you with your expenses, or are you on your own?
No, I'm on my own, but the union will reimburse once I write the, FACO reimburse me once I write the.
Oh, good.
Red seal. Up to, I think it's like 850 or something like that.
So this clock here is a pretty good deal for tradesmen like welders and.
Oh God, I was with the internationals with the building trade union for years, mm-hmm. and I went to, switched over to Clack. Started been working for Clack since 08, and never missed a beat yet. Yeah.
it's my second time here, and I seem to be really focused on training, like getting away from the college system and kind of doing
we're working together with them, trying to get more sponsored programs and accredited. Like the welding, now they're branching out into some different ones, hopefully in the next few years, with pipe, carpentry, electrical, and there's another one. Why not?
Oh, absolutely.
Right. When monopolies doesn't do any good for anybody, right?
Well, the college system doesn't like competition. I mean, I've worked for them for 20 years, and I tell you, it's a really good job. Like your pension, your wages, you know, the time off, everything is working really good. But if I was working for a private company, there's no way they could give me the perks that a college could. No way. So it has its advantages, but it also has a disadvantage.
Well, I work up in the patch, so I don't think I could go back to a 9-to-5 job and only having 2 days off a week and stuff, right? When a month off at Christmas, a month off in the summer, 7 days off every turn.
So what are you actually doing up there?
We're construction, we're building it. We're building them like the SAGD.
I don't know what those are.
Steam assisted gravity drain.
Okay.
Yeah. So there's 6,500 people working up there.
And how's this downturn affected you guys?
Oh, big time.
Oh, it has.
Oh, yeah. This is probably one of the only ones going up there. The rest are just upgrades and retro, you know, and maintenance and stuff like that. But new.
So you're lucky.
Yeah.
Okay.
For sure. No doubt.
Because I've got a.
Everyone's name hired for the most part.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you pretty well got a pretty good crew. Like here.
Yeah. Well, yeah. We're at 1,100 coming out work for.
Because I've got a few buddies down below, and a couple of them are laid off. Lori is still working out of Fort Mac, but he's now down into a construction job. He went from, they were testing the soil, and it's been so long since I talked to him. They were
like geotechnical stuff.
I think so, yeah. They were testing soil. And then that went for a big shift.
Mm-hmm.
And then he got a job as a laborer.
What did he do? What he got to do?
Yeah, and you know, money's money. And I've got two other friends that actually have worked in two different places up there, one male, one female, that are cooks. And apparently they are doing really well up there. And mm-hmm. I don't know, 1,200 man camp or something. Mm-hmm. But Wendy just got laid off here a couple weeks ago. When they had a big fire up mm-hmm. there, she got shipped out, went back up there, and then I guess they sold. Lock, stock, and barrel. They sold the whole trailers and everything. And she said, well, where goes my job?
It's terrible.
And now there's so many other people competing for just a few cooking jobs that, you know.
Well, that's why I'm taking this, because even though, like, I'm a member of the board of directors with Clyde, but mm-hmm. I'm a member, elected member sitting on the board, right? So I know a lot of people. I take care of all the union, like the job steward on site. So our agreements covered all trades. What Black is it's constricted.
Yep.
So instead of just, and I know so many people, and that's what kind of kept me going through my work. But even before this job, it took like 4 months because I didn't have the ticket.
Yep.
I've always been able to get work, which just based on my experience and the people, you know. So you got to be able to stand out. Like you were saying, I have friends of mine who are superintendents and general foremen working on the tools and just doing whatever they can do just to keep working. Friend of marine engineer or laboring and, you know, whatever again. Smart, smart men.
Yeah.
Working at jobs they're extremely overqualified for.
Yeah.
But in the same breath, they're
paychecks and
paychecks.
Yeah. Because I got. I try to let my apprentices know that, you know, don't stop with the millwright ticket. Because, like, a lot of my guys are forestry, so sawmills, pulp mills, and mines are the three meat and potatoes of the apprenticeship program in BC. You got oil and gas and hospitals and that, but, you know, few and far between.
Mm-hmm.
And now they're starting to, commodities are going down a little bit, so now with the lumber agreement and a few other things, sawmills are cutting back because the allowable mm-hmm. cut and all this other stuff. And these mill rates are going to get laid off. And I said, you guys, you know, go get a welding ticket.
Pipe ticket, whatever.
Yeah, do whatever you need to do, because if you've got your mill rate ticket, electrical background, and you can weld, you move right to the top mm-hmm. of the line. And now they're starting to go, oh, yeah, so, but I'll never get the electrical apprentice. I said, well, you know, God helps those who help themselves. I mean, you might have to quit that job mm-hmm. in the sawmill and go run cable trays and pull cable for a year or two and diversify.
Yep.
And they don't want to quit.
I get into materials then 6 years ago in preservation and all that, right?
And they don't want to quit because they figure they're going to lose their seniority and they're going to lose their holiday pay. And I tell them, you know, probably 50% of our mills in BC over the next 10 years are gone. We've already lost 75% in the last 10 years. And they got a couple big mills up north that are producing, you know, 2 million board feet a day. So instead of having a bunch of these little mills all over half an acre, they just have one big monster and they just feed it logs mm-hmm. from everywhere.
With the company I'm with, we got the engineering, field engineering execution for the Squamish wood fiber. So we're hoping we're gonna get the construction in, but that is first. I'd love to get over there for the first one in Canada to be part of the first LNG. Yeah. Hopefully, just like,
boy, that's going to open up doors. But man, there's probably thousands of people just chomping at the bit to get into that.
Oh, for sure.
And I don't even know if they put the bids out for contracts yet.
No, well, the company that I work for now, they have the engineering portion of it now. Whether or not they're going to get the,
because it's a dog eat dog world out there.
Oh,
it's
is, and like you said, you have to be able to stand out now in a crowd. You got to educate yourself. You got to not just you're good with his hands. He's smart. You got to be able to prove it with a piece of paper.
And that's the funny thing, because there's guys out there that are packing paper that are just disastrous.
Okay, no.
And there's guys out there with no paper that, you know, you can get any job in the plant and away they go.
Yeah.